Great. Welcome to the World Christianity Project. Today's topic is going to be the Holy Spirit and Global Pentecostalism. Thank you so much for joining us. Today we have the delight to welcome with us as our major speaker, our lecturer, Dr. Alan Anderson. Dr. Anderson was born in London, but reared in Zimbabwe, where he completed his higher education and first theological appointments in South Africa. He served as a minister in the principal of Tshwane Theological College near Pretoria and part-time researcher at the University of South Africa. In 1995, he joined Selly Oaks Colleges as director of the Center for New Religious Movements, and in 1999 became honorary lecturer at the University of Birmingham and then later lecturer at the university. Dr. Anderson was awarded a chair in 2005, and his main interests are in the areas of history, mission, and theology of Pentecostalism in Africa and also Asia. He is the author of 4 books on South African Pentecostalism, 1 on African independent churches, and 3 books on global Pentecostalism that have received international acclaim. Dr. Anderson's Introduction to Pentecostalism has been translated and published into Spanish, and is being published into translated into 3 other languages and is now in a 2nd edition. Dr. Anderson is also the author of many articles and joint edited 3 collections on Pentecostalism. He is the editor of the peer-reviewed journal Pentecost Studies. Dr. Anderson is a founding member of the European Research Network on Global Pentecostalism, which conducts research in 4 European universities. And he is also serving on the International Editorial Board of 4 academic journals. Dr. Anderson, thank you for being with us today. And I'd like to also introduce Dr. Clifton Clark, who earned his PhD degree at the University of Birmingham and researched under the mentorship of Dr. Alan Anderson while there. Dr. Clark also holds degrees from the University of Derby in the UK and from the University of Nottingham. Dr. Clark has written a number of books and articles on the topic of African Christianity, including Agbukalu and Africa's Christianity, a tribute essay in PNUMA, the Journal of the Society for Pentecostal Studies. Also, African Christology, Jesus in Post-Missionary African Christianity, published in 2010, and most recently published in 2014, Pentecostal Theology in Africa. Would you please give our speakers today a warm round of applause? Dr. Anderson, you may begin your lecture at any time. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much for that introduction. And I'm going to just go straight into the subject. You will see that when I'm talking about Pentecostalism, of course, when you talk about Pentecostalism, you also have to think about the emphasis on the Holy Spirit that is part of Pentecostal existence, really. But you do need to first of all, understand what is meant by Pentecostalism, because people in certain parts of the world have different understandings of what is meant by the term. There's a plethora of movements which are accepted by scholars as Pentecostalism, but there is absolutely no theological uniformity. And so that's important to understand at the beginning. There's no single form of Pentecostalism. There's no clear-cut theological criteria by which Pentecostalism can be defined. So I tend to define Pentecostalism in very broad and overlapping terms, but particularly using historical criteria as to origins. So the first one is what we call the classical Pentecostals, most of which had their beginnings at the start of the 20th century. And then secondly, there are independent churches from the same era, especially those in Africa, Asia, particularly in India and China. But statistics, which are so frequently quoted, always includes other things like charismatics in older churches. These are as a result of the charismatic movement that took place in the 1960s, starting in North America, but also in other parts of the world at that time. And particularly the most numerous of these charismatics are Roman Catholic charismatics, who are actually just as numerous as classical Pentecostals are. So Pentecostalism also includes what I would consider the fastest growing sector, the independent megachurches and so-called neo-charismatics that started in the mid-1970s. They often promote a prosperity gospel and probably are the most controversial of the different forms of Pentecostalism. Some of these prominent megachurches have been hit by financial and sexual scandals, and some of you will be familiar with some of these. So when I talk here about Pentecostalism and Pentecostal, it refers to all these different types. Now, as to facts and figures, these are notoriously difficult to come by. The most frequently quoted ones are those of Todd Johnson at Gordon Conwell and his team, who estimated that Pentecostalism had 631 million adherents in 2014, which is about a quarter of the world's Christians. And this figure was predicted to rise to almost 800 million by 2025. This number was placed at only 63 million in 1970. North America made steady progress in the 20th century, but classical Pentecostalism there, whilst influential, is not as significant as is sometimes claimed. It's only about 4% of the North American population, and you can compare that to 24% of Catholics and 18% of mainline Protestants and 11% Baptist. The other northern continent is very different. Europe still has significant remnants of the former state churches, whether Catholic, Orthodox, Protestant, or Anglican. Although classical Pentecostals there have made modest increases, they still remain a very small minority, and across Europe it would be less than 2% of the overall population, except for Portugal, because in Portugal Pentecostalism is also influenced by the vibrant Brazilian variety. But they are probably more significant as a proportion of the church-going population in Europe. Pentecostalism doesn't do as well where there is a strong national church, unless there is more religious plurality with a significant minority of free churches, as is the case in European countries like Romania and Ukraine, where the numbers of classical Pentecostals are greater than in any other European nation. But if we want to talk about the growth of Pentecostalism, we have to turn to Africa, Asia, and Latin America, what I would call the majority world. Taken as a whole, it was the fastest growing section of Christianity in the 20th century, one of the most remarkable occurrences in church history. I'm going to quote Harvey Cox a little here from his book, Fire from Heaven, The Rise of Pentecostal Spirituality in the 21st century, and his well-rehearsed position on the inevitable secularization. When he writes of Pentecostalism, he talks about it as a manifestation of the unanticipated reappearance of primal spirituality in our time. Although American Pentecostal denominations have been aggressive in their missionary and evangelistic efforts, at least two-thirds of Pentecostalism is now in the majority world, and less than a quarter of its membership is of European descent. More recently, the greatest increase has been in sub-Saharan Africa, in Indonesia, the Philippines, and South Korea, and throughout Latin America. The rapidly growing house church movement in China is mostly of a Pentecostal type, even though it may not recognize itself as being Pentecostal, to use that Western term. But there are enormous buildings holding thousands of worshippers in many parts of the world, which also reflect an emerging Pentecostal middle class. Although predominantly Pentecostals are a grassroots movement who appeal particularly to disadvantaged and underprivileged people. American-founded classical Pentecostal denominations are rapidly growing in many parts of the world, but the vast majority of their international membership is from Latin America, Africa, and Asia. Nevertheless, as Robert Wuthnow reminds us, stating this is not enough unless you also give sufficient attention to the global networks and the links, especially those that have originated in the USA. Now, that's by way of introduction. I'm going to look at the origins of Pentecostalism very briefly, its driving motivations, which I may spend more time on, and its future. If we have time for the future, we'll do it. Otherwise, it's not that important because future predictions are impossible. So we've seen this remarkable expansion of Pentecostalism in the last century, an expansion that has altered religious demographics considerably. So, origins and proliferation of Pentecostalism. Pentecostalism probably is the most rapidly expanding religious movement in the 20th century. But where did it come from? In answering this question, there are three historical truths that I believe are very important. First, there was much continuity with evangelical holiness and healing movements that preceded early Pentecostalism in the 19th century. It didn't suddenly appear from heaven, as some would have us believe. Even speaking in tongues, which is one of the most divisive aspects of the early movement, did not suddenly appear at the beginning of the 20th century, and early Pentecostals themselves, then as now, were by no means united in their theology of tongues. The second point is that there was no one place of origin, despite the fairly widespread claims that it all began at Azusa Street in downtown Los Angeles in 1906. Contemporary Pentecostalism is the product of development, a long process, with precedents going back to a much earlier time. Its history was in continuity with the revivalist movements out of which it emerged. The Azusa Street Revival was indeed an important center in the early internationalizing of the movement, but it remains one center among several, even in North America, some of which preceded it. And there were other significant networks and centers of influence worldwide. Pentecostalism, as we know it today, has many beginnings, sometimes connected and sometimes isolated. It was in a process of formation for at least the first two decades, and one might postulate that it never ceased being in a process of transition. And the third fact that I want to put forward is there have been many waves of Pentecostalism. It's incorrect to speak about three waves of Pentecostalism in North America, even there, as in anywhere else in the world. Now, Peter Wagner is thought to be the one who started this threefold typology of classical Pentecostalism, the charismatic movement, and the so-called third wave. But there were other significant movements in North America that do not easily fit into the scheme, like the Latter Rain movement, which began in the 1940s, and the Jesus People in the 1960s. So the internationalizing of the charismatic movement from the 1960s onwards eroded the isolation of independent Pentecostal churches in the global South. But these changes had already been brewing for decades. After the fall of colonialism, new nation states were created. Many of them were resistant to foreign cultural symbols, including Western hegemony in ecclesiastical affairs. And nowhere was this more apparent than in China after 1949. But the entire majority world was affected by this. China had been Christianity's largest mission field, but it developed its own forms of Christianity without recourse to the outside world. Now, we may describe much of this as affected by Pentecostalism, but applying this term to Chinese churches indiscriminately is just as inappropriate as it might be to talk about independent churches in sub-Saharan Africa. India's independent churches might be more like classical Pentecostal churches, but even this has to be qualified. Latin America had more than a century of independence And so it had its own momentum, and their Pentecostalism took a different turn, not unaffected by what was happening in North America. Nevertheless, large denominations founded by Latin Americans emerged from the mid-1950s onwards, sometimes referred to as the second phase of Pentecostalism in Latin America, following the first denominations founded largely by foreigners. And so you have other parts of the world with similar patterns, like the Philippines, also with its majority Catholicism. Filipino leaders have emerged to form new movements that have had a considerable impact on the religious and political scene there. And so these independent churches have proliferated worldwide. In most recent years, there have been a complex network of new independent churches that have proliferated. Some of them have been rather heterodox in theology, but we won't go into those right now. The recent history of Pentecostalism is littered with revival movements causing schisms that have actually become its defining feature. My friend Cecil M. Robick says that Pentecostalism has taken 100 years to create as many schisms as the whole of Christianity has taken 2,000 years to produce. Now that is probably true. But once the charismatic movement came into the Western world and into the mainline churches, Pentecostal ideas and practices became more acceptable to traditional forms of Christianity. But you can also see this as one result of the privatization of religion from the 1960s onwards. Established churches no longer held monopoly and authority over all things sacred. We could argue that charismatic Christianity provided a panacea for the spiritual deficit in organized religion and in Western society as a whole. Harvey Cox says that not only were people disillusioned with traditional religions in the 1960s, but they were also disappointed by the bright promises of science and progress. After the 1980s, the Pentecostalization of the older churches outside the Western world, especially in Africa and Asia, accelerated as these churches adjusted to the rapid growth of new Pentecostal churches in their midst. They began to accept their methods, particularly appealing to the young and the urbanized people. Simultaneously, these new forms of Pentecostalism exhibited a fierce independence and eschewed denominations and preferred associations in loose fellowships. This was the beginning of networking that has been a characteristic of the new forms of Pentecostalism. Megachurches operate in cities like Lagos in Nigeria, Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, Seoul in Korea, and Singapore, but also in unexpected European places like Kiev in the Ukraine, a large church with a Nigerian pastor, in Budapest and in Uppsala. These are European cases, the largest congregations in their respective countries. In London, the largest congregation is predominantly Nigerian. So the megachurches form networks of similar churches across the world, and these transnational associations are not only from the north to the south, but also from the south to the south and from the east to the south. Sometimes in the north, most of these transnational churches have been able to break free from their ethnic minority character. But now I want to move on to what is perhaps one of the most important parts of the lecture, to talk about the driving motivations behind Pentecostalism. And the first one I describe as missiological, and you will find that these different categories often overlap. There's a lot of similarity between the different ways in which I will explain these. So the missiological factors, first of all. Pentecostalism is, as the title of my latest book is concerned, it's an ends of the earth form of Christian mission. As I've written elsewhere, Pentecostalism is fundamentally a missionary movement by nature. The early Pentecostals made a theological link between their experience of spirit baptism and mission. So just as spirit baptism was classical Pentecostalism's central and most distinctive doctrine, so mission is its central and most important activity. Their primary reason to exist is to evangelize and spread their influence worldwide. These constant efforts to expand are underpinned by a firm evangelical belief in the Bible. They, as all evangelicals do, they believe the Bible is an independent source of authority, one that resonates with local customs and relates better to a spiritual and holistic worldview. And also, they have theological convictions based on their common experience of the Spirit, who empowers believers' mission to the world. This personal conversion of individuals is the primary goal of these evangelistic efforts. Pentecostalism's incessant evangelism, offering healing from sickness and deliverance from evil spirits, draws large crowds, and its organized system of following up contacts mean that more unchurched people are reached with the message and joined to Pentecostal communities. Pentecostalism is also culturally flexible. They have an experiential and participatory liturgy. They offer a place to feel at home for people who are often lost in urbanization. And they offer a measure of religious continuity with the past spirit world. And at least to some observers, they have an appearance of an egalitarian community, meeting the felt needs of ordinary people. These factors all combine to provide an overarching explanation for the appeal of Pentecostalism and the transformation of Christianity in the majority world, what I also call Pentecostalization of mainline Christianity. This brings us to the aspect of indigenization that occurs in Pentecostalism, probably more accurately called contextualization. Pentecostalism has flexibility, or what Pentecostals will call freedom in the spirit, which gives it an innate ability to make itself at home in almost any context. To their credit, the early Pentecostal missionaries, who were largely untrained, practiced indigenous church principles. They quickly found thousands of local leaders who took their message much further than they were able to do. This swift transfer to local leadership was unprecedented in the history of Christianity, and many Pentecostal churches became indigenous and three-self, or self-governing, self-supporting, and self-propagating. I'm sure these are familiar concepts to all of you. And they became three-self churches before the older missions had even begun the process. But these churches were also self-contextualizing. The reason for the very existence of Pentecostalisms is their conviction in the power of the Spirit moving in the church. They view the church primarily as a gathering of local believers, as most evangelicals do, rather than an institution. And they place great stress on church planting, once again, as most evangelicals do. The downside is that this view often creates rampant individualism, causing a proliferation of new denominations, some of which may be no more than a handful of people. But the more Pentecostals divided, the more they multiplied. Now, linked to that, of course, are the theological factors. Pentecostals give credit to the Holy Spirit for almost everything that takes place in their activities, whether they are large or small, whether they are weird or sensible. An emphasis on receiving a conscious experience of the Spirit is a common characteristic to different kinds of Pentecostalism. The spiritual world of most societies worldwide is a personal world, an interrelated world, and an independent world. The power of the Spirit, which is a power greater than any other power, threatens survival, and this is good news to emphasize how the power of the Spirit overcomes all other kinds of power. And so there's also a human need for divine involvement, that God is not detached and far away and out of touch with everyday life, but But God comes down through the person of the Holy Spirit into life as it is lived in ordinary villages and towns and cities throughout the world. So the pervading spirit portrayed by Pentecostal preachers gave Christianity a new vibrancy and relevance. It gave the appearance of a divine involvement in human affairs. And this absorbed the whole of life and not just a dichotomized spiritual part of life. Often this was a release of emotion, a catharsis, a cleansing process that took place. Many scholars have criticized an over-dependence or over-emphasis on the spirit and emotionalism in some Pentecostal churches, but often I think this misses the point. These churches, like many of the older ones, are limited by their humanness and they often need correction, but their innovative Christianity takes seriously the popular religious world with its own existential needs. They are able to adapt to and fulfill people's religious aspirations, which continues to be their strength. They proclaim a divine encounter through the Spirit and the involvement of breaking through of the sacred into the mundane in miraculous answers to prayer. Healing from sickness is one of those answers. Deliverance from hostile evil forces, from demons and evil spirits. But perhaps above all, there is a heady and a spontaneous spirituality that refuses to separate the spiritual from the physical or the sacred from the secular. These are all important factors in the growth of Pentecostalism. Often generalizations are made by social scientists about what they observe as phenomena. But the growth of Pentecostalism has theological factors, and these must be considered. The emphasis on a personal, heartfelt experience of God through the Spirit is offered to all people without preconditions. It enables ordinary women, people who are uneducated, people who are poor, to be powerful and assertive in societies where they've been marginalized. They offer solutions to their felt needs in their varieties. This continues to draw people in the majority world to Pentecostal churches. When your God is all-encompassing, omnipotent, and a personal God who enters into a personal relationship with you as an individual believer, without preconditions, everything becomes a matter for potential prayer. The born-again experience focuses on a radical break with the past. It attracts young people disenchanted with the ways of their parents. Over 40 years ago, the Anglican bishop John V. Taylor, who was for many years a missionary in Uganda in Africa, says, "I believe the time has arrived when we must take into account all that is positive in the Pentecostal movement if we hope to press further forward along any of the various roads of liturgical renewal, interfaith dialogue, the indigenization of Christianity, experiments in Christian community, and group experience, the ministry of healing, especially towards psychotics and addicts, and new approaches to church union." So we might add to this the relationship between theology and spirituality, and as I've already mentioned, the important ministry of prayer in Pentecostal churches. All these elements are important in considering the value of charismatic experience for the church today. But to highlight the first two, renewal in church life has always brought new vigor and vitality that especially appealed to younger people. And it's usually first expressed in liturgical changes. We saw that in the Catholic Church with the Vatican Council, how the renewal of the Vatican Council brought about liturgical changes first and foremost. The charismatic movement has spearheaded a return to scripture in song, which is now very common in churches all over the world of many different kinds. They brought a new psalmody that has refreshed many of the older churches. Interfaith dialogue is a more controversial aspect to consider, especially for evangelicals. But because Pentecostals are so often in the forefront of that encounter with other faiths, often confrontationally so, we have lessons for the entire Christian community that Pentecostals have learned in real-life contact rather than in the academic ivory towers of pluralistic Western philosophers of religion and theologians. Although often unconscious of the fact, Pentecostals have absorbed so much of the religious and cultural context into their Christian faith that they have much in common with other faiths. Amos Yong writes of discerning the spirit in other faiths, and he calls for a theology of religions from the perspective of pneumatology. And then I'll briefly mention cultural and social factors. Pentecostalism has been able to tap into ancient religious beliefs with one eye on a changing world of modernity. This combination of the old and new has enabled it to attract people who relate to both worlds. And often that is the case, especially in the majority world. It's also been on a mission to subvert convention. Unlike older forms of Christian mission, its methods were not as dependent on Western specialists and trained clergy, and the transmission of Western forms of Christian liturgy and theology and leadership. In fact, Pentecostalism is in its earliest forms broke down the dichotomy between clergy and laity, that is the legacy of older churches. Revival movements challenged Western dominance, and they created a multitude of new indigenous churches, a type of Christianity in local idiom that was both a cultural protest movement and a movement emphasizing power to overcome the evil spirit world and promoting the miraculous. So Pentecostalism addressed the allegations of foreignness of Christianity and irrelevance of Christianity in societies that often considered Christianity to be a Western importation. Pentecostalism broke down those kind of barriers. Although not always overt or effective, the liberation of ordinary people from colonial and ecclesiastical hegemony and the liberation of women from male patriarchy, Pentecostalism encouraged free enterprise in a global religious market. And of course, these developments included multiple schisms. Even though they increased division, they also proliferated local leadership and encouraged religious competition. As I've written and many have observed, the more the Pentecostals divided, the more they multiplied. What is often not appreciated is the extent to which Pentecostalism takes on distinctive forms in different social contexts. It's able to adapt. It's able to, with its energizing worship and liturgies, its music and dance, its prayer with the free use of the emotions, and its communities of concerned and committed believers. These are all aspects that differ from society to society. And the more I travel the world, the more I'm amazed at the creativeness and the innovation of different Pentecostal churches in different communities and different societies. The ministry of healing and the claims of the miraculous have assisted Pentecostalism in its appeal to a world where supernatural events are taken for granted. So the offer of a better and a more prosperous life. Now here, of course, we come into the realm of the prosperity gospel, which is popular in some forms of Pentecostalism. I need to emphasize only in some forms of Pentecostalism, but seems to be increasing among megachurches in the majority world. However, this offer of prosperity to people struggling in poverty and despair is not quite the same as it being offered in Dallas and Fort Worth or in somewhere in the American Bible Belt. In some forms of Pentecostalism, oracular prophecy fulfills a particular need, and some so-called prophets become counselors, pastors, and healers at the same time. And then finally, talking about the driving motivations, I want to talk just briefly about transnational and globalizing factors. Pentecostalism has always been transnational, just as it has always been a missionary movement. And it's been based on personal enterprise, on ubiquitous volunteerism, and the constant multiplication of multi-centered, variegated organizations whose driving ambition is to expand. So in different parts of the world, it has developed different characteristics and identities without losing its transnational connections. It also has a transnational metaculture. It uses the mass media, like, of course, makes it accessible to people all over the world. It sets up new networks that often incorporate the word international in their titles. There are frequent conferences with international speakers that again reinforce this transnationalism, and the growth of churches that provide total environments for their members. These are all features of this multidimensional Pentecostalism. Globalization has affected the spread of Pentecostalism immensely. The phenomenon of globalization is usually seen as a radical departure from the modernizing paradigm by which the developing world will eventually resemble the developed Western world. And of course, that modernizing paradigm includes the idea that the world will become increasingly secular. However, globalization implies fragmentation and disjunction, diversity and multiple identities, a tension between the global and the local. Pentecostalism provides a splendid example of a globalized religion, and particularly in megachurches that have proliferated in many parts of the world with their common practices, the use of the mass media, and the patterns of activity. Simon Coleman, he studied a particular charismatic church in Sweden, and he talks about globalization by reference to three characteristic dimensions of Pentecostalism. His book is called The Globalization of Charismatic Christianity. And the first of those features is the use of mass communications media to promulgate and disseminate its ideas. Secondly, a local organization that promotes internationalism through global travel and networking, conferences, megachurches that function like international corporations. And thirdly, a global orientation or a global metaculture, a charismatic metaculture, if you like, that promotes ideas that take off throughout the world and different parts of the world. The health and wealth advocates of the prosperity gospel are as much at home in Lagos and Rio as they are in Tulsa or Fort Worth. And sadly, in many cases, the only ones who get rich in poverty-ravaged countries are the prosperity preachers themselves. Networks is another feature of globalization. And these networks, as I've already said, they transcend national boundaries, and they're not always north-south. In the present time, they take on the appearance of new denominations. And of course, you know, we have to admit that some of these Pentecostal churches leave much to be desired, especially the new ones, those with wealthy leaders whose questionable and exploitative practices continue to be exposed in public media. And then lastly, in the next 3 minutes, I will just touch on future prospects. Of course, we all have heard about the southward shift in Christianity. Andrew Walls calls the southward shift in Christianity's center of gravity. But this has come at the same time as the expansion and emergence of Pentecostalism. In Africa in particular, Christians exceeded Muslims for the first time ever in 1985. And African Christians are now in the majority in Africa. That's including North Africa. Lamin Sane calls this a continental shift of historical proportions. There are now well over four times as many Christians in Africa today as there were in 1970, so in just over 40 years. Almost the same is true of Asia. The Christian population of Latin America over this period has almost doubled. Of course, some of this has to do with differentiations in population growth, but it remains true that much of the global growth of Christianity has occurred through conversion in the global south, where the influence of Pentecostalism is the strongest. We still remain with Christianity being approximately the same proportion of world population as it was 100 years ago. But the nature of that population has changed so remarkably from being an almost entirely North American and European movement to being predominantly a African, Asian, and Latin American movement. I think because time is running out now, I'm going to move right to my last part of this lecture. So within a century of its commencement, charismatic forms of Christianity are now in most countries of the world, and they have affected Christianity in our contemporary world, all forms of Christianity. However, we regard or manipulate the statistics on affiliation. But as Cox, Harvey Cox, has pointed out in his subtitle, religion itself has been reshaped through the rise of what he calls Pentecostal spirituality. Whatever our opinion is, or our personal experience of Pentecostalism might be, it is a movement of such magnitude that Christianity itself has been irrevocably changed. The mushrooming growth of Pentecostal and charismatic churches, the Pentecostalization of older Protestant and Catholic churches, especially in the majority world, is a fact of our time. With all its warts and wounds, the composite movement continues to expand and increase across the globe. The enormous growth of charismatic Christianity in Asia, Africa, and Latin America also means that it may continue to expand and influence all types of Christianity there. In creative ways, Pentecostalism has promoted a globalized Christianity that has not lost touch with its local context. So at least for the foreseeable future, the continued vitality of charismatic Christianity is probably assured. I'll stop there.
Please join me in, would you please join me in thanking our speakers? Thank you, Dr. Anderson, for that fascinating lecture. Let me just run a sound check again. Dr. Clark, can you hear us and participate?
Yes, I can hear you clearly.
Great. Very glad to hear that. Then we should all be together. Dr. Anderson, before I, Dr. Clark, would you care to respond first to Dr. Anderson's very fine lecture?
Well, I mean, just to basically endorse all what Dr. Anderson has said, and from a personal experience, I've recently come back from Nigeria and Ghana, and also in, I was in Europe, in Hamburg and in London, and I was particularly looking at some of these transnational movements, and I'm just overwhelmed, really, and seeing the kinds of organizations that we are seeing. For example, in Hamburg, I was with it's an African network of churches, because of course in Germany you cannot have an official church by itself unless it comes under some of these broader denominations. And so just working with these different sort of transnational groups, these different churches forming networks together, has been quite interesting. And then particularly the kind of needs that they have, I'm recognized that a lot of them are from and disjointed to some extent from their local denominations, in whether it's in Ghana or in Nigeria, and some of the local pastors, they're trying to make connections with Europe and trying to make connections in the United States, and the kind of needs that come out of that in terms of training, education, and development, and even trying to understand how do you become a vibrant multicultural church in London. How do you connect with postmodern Britain? How do you connect with post-Christian France, and so on and so forth? And how do you move beyond just becoming a Nigerian church and becoming a church that attracts not just Nigerian but other Africans and even indigenous populations? And so that transnational piece in terms of how the global south is kind of engaging missiologically with the West and trying to re-energize and reappropriate the faith, it's one of the things that I'm just delighted to be a part of.
Very good. Dr. Anderson, if I could ask you one question, it's really got two parts, so I'll ask the two parts sequentially. First of all, you opened your lecture by informing us that there's no single theological theme that, or theological principle that unites all of these movements that we call Pentecostal. I think in one regard, that would actually make the playing field so much more simple for evangelicals and other groups of Christians if they were to understand that Pentecostalism at its core is not defined theologically. Did I understand you rightly, that there's a theological principle that unites these Pentecostal movements?
Yes, I think this is quite controversial in the North American context, but not so much in other parts of the world. But I do not think that there is a common theological principle. You will find, of course, that there are some of the large denominations in North America, and some of those in Europe too, will insist on speaking in tongues as a sign of spirit baptism, and they would make that their defining characteristic. However, that is only true of possibly the majority of classical Pentecostal churches, but is not a feature of new forms of Pentecostalism that are forming in many parts of the world. So if there is any defining theological characteristic, then it would be in a very vague sense an emphasis on the experience of the Spirit, which may or may not be accompanied by speaking in tongues.
Thank you for that clarification. And then to take us to the second part of the question, what I do understand you to be saying is the uniting factor of these movements we call Pentecostal is the contextualization, this Pentecostalization process, this drive towards mission. Could that drive towards mission, that contextualization, be defined theologically and actually be the theological principle?
Well, in as much as you consider mission to be a theological principle, yes, indeed. Because, as I said, just as the experience of the Spirit was the kind of factor that all Pentecostals agreed on, the actual activity that comes out of that experience of the Spirit is mission. And that mission, because of the way in which it is handled through the freedom of the Spirit, is contextual. And I think that's the important thing. The Holy Spirit enables contextualization to take place. I don't think there's any other way that it can happen except through the moving of the Holy Spirit upon a particular culture, a particular language, a particular context in which people find themselves. And I think if that could be described as a theological factor that unifies all forms of Pentecostalism, then indeed it is the case.
If I can make a... Can I just jump in there?
Yeah.
I think in addition to that, the missiological perspective is the experiential piece. And I think what we are seeing is, over the years, as sort of an enlightenment approach to Christianity, where Christianity pretty much defined by dogma and by small cerebral activities. What we are actually seeing with the growth of Pentecostalism is a religion as experience. And we see that religion not sort of compartmentalized into just ideas and theories, but a religion that is lived out in everyday life. It's the way we live, the way we eat, the way we experience God in our work, in our schools. And so in addition to that sort of missiological drive, I think one of the defining factors is that we're moving away from a purely sort of enlightenment understanding of Christianity to a Christianity that is governed by the way we experience God in our everyday lives. And that's one of the very important aspects that I see in the sort of connecting points where and commonalities amongst the sort of Pentecostal movement.
May I ask one final question then, and then I'll take it to the floor. We'll have our students also ask you questions. My last question would be this. In the North American context, particularly the ethical context, there's kind of a debate going on whether the theology of the future will will necessarily engage Enlightenment critiques of classical Christianity. So as we look out to the future, there's two groups wondering, will global theology necessarily engage all of the critical questions that the Enlightenment has imposed on Western theology, or will global theology actually lose much of its Enlightenment character? Can I ask that question of you two? So, in the future, do we need to be studying all of these critical pieces of theology that we've developed in response to the Enlightenment, or will that not necessarily be useful in a global context?
Well, speaking personally, I think that many of those critical comments and ways of approaching theology are often the cause of division between Christians more than anything else. And I think part of the, if you like, the Protestant legacy has been to create division. And division is often because of minor theological points. Of course, that doesn't mean that as Christians we should ignore the theology. I think that's important. But I also think that that looked at from the perspective of the non-Western world, I don't like using that term, but the majority world, the world outside North America and Europe, I think that Christianity has a very different way of approaching theology. As Dr. Clark said, it is very experiential. It is very much about tapping into the experience of people and the context in which they find themselves and finding answers to their existential needs.
And if I can just add to that, I think one of the exciting things and new developments that we're seeing in the globe, the growth of global Pentecostalism, is the growth of the Pentecostal Guild. We not only have people who are sort of practitioners, as we had before, Pentecostalisms were so busy, Pentecostals were so busy preaching the gospel that, you know, they didn't have time to sort of theologically engage with the movement. But what we're seeing now is the growth of Pentecostal and theological institutions, whereby we do see Pentecostal theologians engaging with issues, even in my university here, that I am at, in terms of what's the relationship between theology and science, theology and creation, theology and interfaith dialogue, and theology and things like euthanasia, and what is the position, because if Pentecostalism is going to be global, that it's going to need to engage with these global themes and global challenges. And one of the exciting things I see is that Pentecostal has a sort of theological arm to it that is seeking to engage these more critical questions that comes out of sort of an Enlightenment mindset, and trying to make sense of that and appropriate that to its members.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for those comments. Let me open the floor. And please do not be hesitant to ask your questions. This is a marvelous opportunity. Our first question will come from James.
Hello, I'm James. I have a question addressing both you guys. Both you guys can answer it. I've observed a trend here in the United States, and like I wanted to see if it trickles into the majority world. But my question is, I've seen that the charismatic stream emphasizes experience with the Holy Spirit here in the United States, but has like an absence of discernment, like for the sake of experience, or I'll reward it. I've seen people desiring to be spiritual and experience the presence of God, but in the midst of their pursuit have some unorthodox mindsets. So my question is, in the majority world, has this thought, this trend kind of like trickled into the majority world? That's my question.
Could you say what you mean by an unorthodox mindset, please?
I would say, well, I'm from the charismatic stream, so I would say, like, some things like the prosperity gospel, maybe, the health and wealth. I know you guys kind of like delved into that a little bit. That would kind of be mainly what I would say. So I'm sorry for being kind of broad there, but that would be mainly what I would say with that. So that's what I kind of mean by that. So,
I think there is always a danger that too much of an emphasis on experience can result in some very, what we would call in Britain, dodgy forms of Pentecostalism. So, yes, I agree with you. I don't think I really have much else to say. I think what you are seeing as a trend in North America is also true in other parts of the world. And I do think that one of the reasons for that is often because leaders are not accountable to one another in a way that they should be. And often it's a one-man show, you know, the person will... And unfortunately, that does lead to these kinds of problems that you are alluding to.
And what I would say is that a movement, when it's sort of in its sort of you know, heyday, when it's growing, there's always going to be excessive behaviors, and we've seen that in early Pentecostalism, when the idea of being baptized by fire and baptized with dynamite, we're going to always see this excessive. And certainly, you know, as someone who's lived in Ghana for 10 years, I've seen the excessive behaviors and theology and practices. But one of the encouraging things that I see is what I would call a sort of Pentecostal corrective, and particularly when the corrections are coming from the Pentecostal guild themselves. Take, for example, you have the Church of Pentecost in Ghana and many other sort of charismatic universities. And thanks to the work that Dr. Anderson is doing, who has, you know, many of these scholars have come to the University of Birmingham and gone back to their own church and were able to speak to and challenge, not as outsiders, but challenge some of these excessive behaviors. And I've seen issues of sort of prosperity gospel being challenged by church leaders who are trying to sort of correct their membership. And so it's there. But I see some positive signs that the church is building up a sort of a strong, theologically equipped leadership that are able to sort of govern and deal with these excesses.
And if I can add to that, which of course underlies the fact that we still need theological education. We still need leaders to be trained properly so that they can... speak into the excesses that take place in Pentecostal churches, as long as they have the influence to do that.
Thank you so much for those responses. Our next question will be from Josh.
Hello, thank you very much for this lecture. I'm actually doing my paper for this class on the doctrine of spirit baptism within a global Pentecostal mindset, trying to figure out just what would be some of the major viewpoints. And so it may actually be an impossible and not practical task, but I'm wondering, other than some obvious classical Pentecostal understandings of spirit baptism, what are some of the understandings of spirit baptism maybe among the house churches in China or just in different parts of the world and in different movements, if you don't mind speaking to that?
Wow, that is a massive question. I mean, I think you'd probably be best if you were to do that kind of study. It would be probably best for you to concentrate on one particular type of Pentecostalism, and I would suggest where the debate is the strongest and where the literature is the most frequent would be the classical Pentecostals in North America. So particularly among Assemblies of God and Church of God scholars, there has been extensive debate about spirit baptism. I think if you were to try to take it beyond that, you'd run into all kinds of difficulties. Many churches, for example, don't talk about spirit baptism at all, or they equate spirit baptism with conversion, just as some evangelicals do. So you'll find that. But you'll find there's still an emphasis on gifts of the Spirit, much as people like John Wimber in North America have had a very different theology of Spirit baptism than the classical Pentecostals have. So I think you'll find that there are many differences like that. If you're going to take Spirit baptism as a subject, I think you're going to have to limit the actual way in which you discuss it, especially if you're going to look at the theology itself.
If I can just add to that,
yep, please go ahead.
An interesting aspect, as I observe the experience of spirit baptism in a West African context. The signs of being filled with the Spirit, the most important signs, is not just whether you speak in tongues, but whether you can cast out demons, whether you can demonstrate the miraculous in your life, in your prayers. And so there's not the sort of a fixation on whether or not you can speak in tongues, which is of course is very important there. But you know, a part of that being filled with the Spirit is how it manifests in your life and in your ministry.
Thank you for those responses. Our next question comes from Diana.
This question is for Dr. Anderson. From what you were talking about, the Pentecostal church and how it's a gathering of local believers, and also how there is an emphasis on church planting, and you had mentioned that it's pretty similar to the evangelical church. So what, if any, is the distinction, would be the distinction between like Pentecostal churches and the church planting versus the evangelical church?
That's a very good question. I suppose if I've understood it correctly, I think probably what I would say is that there's not an awful lot of difference in the way church planting takes place. But I would say this, and that is that often church planting outside of Pentecostal context is often based on models that have their origins in the Western world. So, and that would be true of many evangelical churches. You know, there is a fixed way in which what a church looks like. So I think what you have outside the Western world often is because of the freedom in the Spirit, and that was the connection I made there, church planting takes on distinctive forms and distinctive cultures. And so often the type of church that emerges is not the same as anything that has been before. Certainly in the Western context, it's very different. So I'd say that's probably one of the differences. There are differences, but the method is the same.
And Dr. Clark, we'd like to invite you to respond to that too, if you care to.
No, I totally agree. I think that there are similarities, but again, because of the sort of existential, experiential, divine notions that Pentecostals often would say that rather than the denomination is asking them to plant a church, they would say that they received a dream or they got a call from God, and there's that experiential drive towards planting the church, which is often personal and comes out of a personality as opposed to just a sort of ecclesiastical order in terms of and development. Of course that is there, but that personal element and calling and being driven by the Spirit to do it and do it in a particular way, as Dr. Anderson said, is very important.
Thank you so much for that response. Our next question is from Sam.
Hi. I just have a proposal on the underlying doctrine that unites all Pentecostals and Charismatics, similar to the conversation that you had with Dr. Armstrong just before you opened it up to the rest of us. Could the Kingdom of God theology be the underlying doctrine that unites all Pentecostals and Charismatics, where that being the Kingdom of God theology is what causes Pentecostals to pursue supernatural phenomena, also to pursue cross-cultural ministries and to pursue social justice issues? What do you think of that?
It's an interesting idea. I mean, it would be one way of looking at the subject, yes. I mean, you know, you'd have to define what you mean by a Kingdom of God theology, because many parts of the world, people wouldn't have a clue what that means, not because they don't know what the Kingdom of God is, but what the Kingdom of God theology is. It might have a specific connotation in North America that I'm not aware of. But yes, the whole idea of the Holy Spirit comes to make, and of course, you know, when we talk about the emphasis on the Spirit, we also have to bear in mind that the Holy Spirit witnesses to Jesus. There's a very strong Christocentric aspect And that's where the kingdom of God would come in as well, I think. So, yes, I would say that sounds like an interesting way to put it together, but it might just also suffer from a bit of vagueness, which is not bad, of course.
I like that idea. I think some constructive theological development needs to take place in terms of how you develop the concept of the kingdom of God and appropriate it to this particular context. But when I'm thinking about the kingdom of God and thinking about the kingdom of God has come, it's come in power, and in, you know, it's eschatological, it's supernatural, it's experiential, it's an invitation. And so I do think that a case could be made in which the kingdom of God theology that is constructed could be put forward as a proposal as the sort of underlying connection between the Pentecostals and the sort of the charismatics. So get on with that.
Those responses. Our last question will be from Anastasia.
Hi, thank you so much for joining us today and teaching us about this topic. My question relates to kind of an application for students here today. My question is, how can we rightly understand the implications of these global statistics of Pentecostalism as they relate to our own studies, particularly for those of us who plan to do missions work? In other words, how should this knowledge of the growth of Pentecostalism affect missions?
Mm, very good question.
Yes. thank you for that. I think probably what it will do is that when you get out from the Western world, you will discover, even if you are part of an evangelical church or part of a, shall we say, mainline church, you will discover that the churches that you go to have been, to some extent, Pentecostalized. That's the term I would use. They have taken on features which would be much more common and much more bringing churches together than you would find in the Western world, where there is, I think, more division amongst different Christians. So that would be one way in which you would find it. I think you will discover again that as long as there is an openness to the Holy Spirit, I think you will find open doors with people in other parts of the world. I don't think you know, if I can sort of stick my neck out here, I don't think that people involved in mission should see themselves as much as leading people outside the Western world, but rather as partnering and serving people in Africa and Asia and Latin America. And I think if you have that attitude and allow the Holy Spirit to lead you in that way, you will find open hearts and open homes.
I think
Dr. Clark, would you like to have the last word there?
Yeah, that's a very good question, by the way. How does these statistics and what is taking place impact the way we do mission? I do think that the way we have constructed mission historically has to be reinterpreted, and the way mission is taking place globally. Those involved who are passionate about mission, I'm here at Regent University and I'm the professor for missiology here, we do have to take seriously the global shift. We have to understand that God is doing something globally, and the strength of and the weight that is taking place in terms of the positioning of the density of global Christianity is taking place in the global South. And that also means that people in the Western world still have a very important role to play. There is so much growth, there's so much energy, but there is need for missionaries to go out as teachers, to go out as trainers and empowers, and to work alongside many who are in the midst of this great movement. And so, yes, we're not just going across to Africa and India to sort of pagan worlds, but we are going across to support them, as well as here in America or in the UK or elsewhere, to support a global movement that is taking place, and to see how we can empower it, how we can come alongside it and support something that God is doing across the world.
It's honor and delight to be able to host Dr. Alan Anderson, Professor of Mission and Pentecostal Studies at the University of Birmingham in the UK, and also Clifton R. Clark, Dr. Clark, Associate Professor of Global Missions and World Christianity at Regent University. Would you join me in thanking them? Thank you.